Random House Audio presents The Devil's Banker by Christopher Reich. Read for you by Campbell Scott. It is difficult to walk casually with $500,000 taped to your belly. More difficult still when any of the men brushing past you would gladly slit your throat were they to suspect the king's ransom you carried. The man who had chosen the warrior's name Abu Sayyid snaked through the alleys of the smuggler's bazaar, careful to check his impatient step. He was close now, but he could not hurry. To hurry invited attention, and attention meant trouble he could not afford. Around him, shopkeepers leaned in open doorways, smoking cigarettes and sipping cups of tea. He could sense their eyes upon him as they studied his bearing, gauging its strength, deciding whether he was a predator or prey. Instinctively, he stood straighter and thrust his chin forward, but all the while he kept his pace relaxed, his face slack, even as the claws dug into him. The money was divided into 50 packets, each containing $10,000, each wrapped and waterproofed in transparent plastic. The packets had sharp, cruel corners that chafed and cut his flesh. He had been traveling for 36 hours. His chest and back were flayed as if scored by a cat-o'-nine-tails. Only by thinking of the operation was he able to continue. The prospect of the infidel's deaths invigorated him with the strength of the Pharaoh's army. At 4 p.m., the summer sun was at its fiercest. After a brief lull, the bazaar was rousing itself to life. Beneath fluorescent lights, shelves sagged with cartons of Dunhill cigarettes, Toshiba laptops, and Paco Rabanne cologne, all brought overland from Afghanistan to avoid duty and tax. Other windows displayed less mundane goods. Kalashnikov rifles, Colt pistols, and Claymore mines. Hashish, heroin, even human chattel could be had at the right address. If there was a free market on earth, mused Saeed, it was here on the western outskirts of Peshawar, the gateway to the Khyber Pass. Stopping to purchase a cube of diced sugarcane, he cast his gaze behind him. His depthless black eyes scoured the street, checking for the misplaced face, the averted gaze, the anxious dawdler. So close, he must keep his senses keen. He did not believe that the Crusaders knew his identity. Still, he must be cautious. The thought of the Americans brought a contemptuous smile to his lips. Soon they would learn that they could not run. The fire was coming. It would burn them in their heartland. It would scald them from within. And for a moment, the claws loosened their grip. The pain subsided, and he basked in the glow of destruction. Satisfied his trail was clean, Saeed spat out the sinewy cane and crossed the narrow road. To look at, he was no different from any of the thousands of souls who eked out an existence trafficking the porous border that separated Pakistan from Afghanistan. His shalwar kameez, the baggy shirt and trousers that made up the local dress, was filthy and stiff with dried sweat. His black headdress smothered with red alkali dust. His beard belonged to the most fervent of believers, as did the AK-47 he carried slung over a shoulder and the bejeweled dagger strapped to his calf. But Saeed was not Pakistani. Born Michael Christian Montgomery in London, England, Saeed was the bastard offspring of a cancerous British officer and a teenage Egyptian whore. His father had died while he was a boy, leaving him a polished accent and not much more. Unable to care for him, his mother returned to Cairo and gave him over to the madrasas, the religious schools that gifted him with an Islamic education. His childhood was brutish and short. It was a natural progression to the camps where he learned the creed of the gun, memorized the verse of violence, and worshipped at the altar of rebellion. At 20, the Sheik found him. At 21, Michael Christian Montgomery ceased to exist. It was Abu Mohammed Saeed who swore the oath, accepted the mark, and joined Hijra. Skirting a convoy of carts piled high with Korean fabrics, Tibetan rugs, and Panasonic televisions still in their factory packaging, he walked past the Tikram Mosque. A horn blared in his ear, loud, very loud, but from another universe altogether. Then he saw his destination. The gold letters emblazoned on a black field, Bhatia's gold and precious jewelry. Guards stood on either side of the doorway, Kalashnikovs to their chest. Said passed them without a glance. They were not there to protect jewelry, but cash, primarily U.S. dollars and gold ingots. Bhatia's reputation as a jeweler might be suspect, but his trustworthiness as a hawaladar, or money broker, was unquestioned. Faizan Bhatia had long served the local smuggling community as its agent of choice. He was the only broker in the region able to handle the large sums that Abu Said required. In Arabic, hawala means to change, and in Hindu, trust. Put simply, it was the hawala broker's job to effect transfers of cash from one city to another. Some of his clients were traders, eager to repatriate their earnings after selling their haul in the bazaar. Others, simple folk wishing to send money home to loved ones in Karachi, Delhi, or Dubai. Both groups shared a distrust of the bureaucracy and paperwork demanded by the country's less-than-solvent banks. Bhatia, a fat Indian with a streak of gray in his hair, stood imperiously behind the counter. As Said approached, he eyed the customer's caked clothing and unwashed face with undisguised contempt. "I would like to make a transfer," Abu Said whispered when he was close enough to taste the man's breath. "It is a matter of some urgency." The Indian did not move. "The Sheik sent me." Faizan Bhatia's eyes flickered, but only for an instant. "Come this way." It was the most god-awful, frightening place she had ever been. Some parts of Jakarta came close. Jakarta with its garish slums, oppressive pollution, and packs of teenage muggers giggling with hostile intent. But here, the unremitting heat, the hostile stares, and worst of all, the burqa, draped over her head and shoulders, baking her like a Christmas goose, this topped it all. Her name was Sarah Churchill, operational designation Emerald, and through her black gauze veil she watched the target advance across the intersection. 2 days she'd been tracking him, up and down the mountain passes, a distance of 60 miles. Her feet were raw and blistered in their leather sandals, her legs fatigued beyond measure. A trio of Indian women clad in red and orange saris scurried across her path, and she mimicked their gait. The second-class shuffle, she called it, head bent, shoulders hunched, eyes fixed to the ground like a dog that's been beaten too much. Drawing in her shoulders, Sarah made herself shrink beneath the full-length sari. Her horizon seemed to dwindle before her, and she bridled at her training. Blend in with your environment. The first rule of tradecraft taught at Fort Moncton, where all good little English boys and girls go to learn to be spies. Ever the prize pupil, she kept her back hunched and continued to hug the inside of the street. She was too tall. That was the problem. You didn't see many Pakistani women who stood 5 feet 9 inches in bare-stockinged feet. Her height came from her father, a 6-foot-4-inch Welshman. Her hair, a raven's black and cut to her shoulders, was her mother's gift, as were her Sierra brown eyes. Her earpiece crackled with static. "Primary still visual?" "He's gone into the store," she whispered. "Bhatia's gold and precious jewelry. It's the bloody hawala, all right. Time to call in the reinforcements."
"Give us a GPS read."
"Coming up."
She found the global positioning device on her belt and hit the locate transmit button. Within a second, the stationary satellites that comprised the Central Intelligence Agency's proprietary GPS had established her exact latitude and longitude to within 6 inches of where she actually stood, and her altitude above sea level to within 4. She'd been transmitting her location every 100 meters since she'd entered the bazaar. Taken together, the coordinates constituted a route marker for the cavalry, or in more dire circumstances, a path to get her the hell out of Dodge. "Emerald, you are mapped, and A-team is moving in to clean up. ETA is 12 minutes.
12 minutes? He could be out the back and halfway back to Pesh by then. Damn it, tell them to hurry.
"Maintain visual," snapped the voice. Sarah held still, staring out at the bustling street. 7,000 miles away, a technician was deciding whether the picture was too red or too green. The Sony micro-digital camera embedded in her sunglasses was a gift from the boys in Langley. She liked to think of it as a welcome to our side of the pond present, given upon her secondment from MI6. The camera's images ran to a transmitter in her belt that relayed both audio and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.